forward and backward, which goes backward. Thank you all. I'm going to ask you to, well, potentially start with fastening a little bit your seatbelt. In the sense that, this is really about networking. This conference is, from top to bottom about networking, but I will take you a little bit out of your comfort zone and bring a lot of IT into this world to then hopefully and potentially convince you and bring you an element of comfort around, this aspect of IT that I will talk about is really going to help you big time going forward in, let's say, automating your networks and therefore, orchestration as the keyword and goes. So basically, this is a slide that we all know that we have seen, I think, by now 20 times during this conference, which is combining 5G on the one hand and then cloud native on the other hand, right? Cloud native stands for what is called container, Kubernetes, and so on, comes from the IT industry, and 5G is, I would say, the next big opportunity for our industry to go again out in the markets and become even more relevant for our customers, right? Now, the call out that I want to make on this slide specifically is on the keyword, a new set of enterprise consumer applications. Applications are, in our view, going to drive more and more in 5G the need for new and better networks that then really go end-to-end, right? And so the contrast is that before and currently today, you have a BSS OSS system that goes that allows you to ask for a new network service that is then going to be, also billable and assurable and so on and so forth, right? We believe that going forward, applications will be driving autonomously for new requests for new network services. That then, at the same time, right-hand side of the slide, are going to have an attribute of being much more distributed than before. Cloud native stands for, it is about container. You are going to distribute it in, split your application into a number of microservices. As you do so, you can start choosing to deploy one side of your application being a microservice on one side of the planet and the other side of your application, another microservice, but still the same application on the other side of the planet. Then somehow that application and the application designer, not necessarily the network designer, the application designer, will assume that there is a network running in between his two parts of the application, two times a microservice, with a network running in between the two of them, right? So what are the domains? End-to-end, one side of the world to the other side of the domain, you have to traverse a number of domains. Now, domains in itself is a word that requires a bit of analysis. When we talk about cross-domain orchestration, it means that you are going to orchestrate something that is called domain, and a domain is something that has an aspect of being a bit fluid. So let me talk about it for 1 second. The one domain is, as an example, the IP optics domain that we had in the first few sessions earlier today, right? So the one domain is the domain that typically has been at length discussed during this session, and it has a bit of a set of properties that Bruno this morning called like complex. Now, of course, he tried to play it down during the discussion to make in the end it simple, but then yet, not quite that simple. If you look at what happens in the large data centers, these football field big data centers, basically there it is all about reproducibility. The one rack has to be exactly the same as the rack next door, while if you look at the one network, you have 1,000 number of, router types, ROADM types, you have basically the different vendors, you have, types all over the place, right? While in a fabric, you really are talking about massive standardization. Two guys operating, football field big data centers. That means in terms of a leaf spine architecture, you are going for, at least compared to the one, a very simple design that is then cloth-based, that is talking about leaf spine type of architecture, 2 or 3 layers. And like that, you are going to try to automate it as much as you can within the realm of what you know that is then therefore called your domain, the fabric, right? There is a new domain arising now very fast. We had a few discussions during this conference too around the edge, right? Now, the edge is the far edge. It is basically a local edge. There are 27 variables that you can classify, that you can use to classify edges. Now, what we call out here is two attributes that make the edge fundamentally different from a WAN domain or a central data center fabric domain. The one aspect is where you talk about a fabric specifically, then you talk about a leaf and a spine and boxes, switches that are really tuned down to, I would say, the Eurocent level in terms of cost, so that you really can roll them out with the hundreds in the data center, right? So that means they are really almost like purpose-built, right? While in the WAN, you really have these boxes that allow you to give, you know, a few hundred of IETF RFCs that they then implement, user plane, control plane, and so on and so forth, right? In the edge, you have the combination of both, because the edge on the one hand is a data center. On the other hand, it is also basically attaching you to the one. That's the essence of the edge in the first place, which is it needs to be connected through to go back to your central data center, right? And in other words, you need a leaf spine type of a set of attributes for the switch together with potentially a one set of attributes for that same switch, because you cannot tolerate for a 4RU system or a 24RU system in terms of number of servers, you cannot tolerate to have and the leaf, and the spine, and the data center gateway, and the PE router, right? It just is economically not viable, so you want to condense all that functionality into one place. The other thing where the edge is really like it is there to run applications. There I am again with the word application. In the data center, the central, you still can leave, you know what, I'm going to do my network service and then have a lifecycle management that is totally separate from the application lifecycle management. In the edge, this is potentially not possible anymore, among others for security reasons, among others for monitoring reasons, BFD sessions and all these type of technologies that you can use, where you are going to set a part of your network all the way down over your WAN at the moment that the application is landing there. In other words, the lifecycle management of your network service has to be in line with the lifecycle management of your application. And therefore, BSS, OSS is what we knew before. Now it is about the lifecycle management of an application, steering the lifecycle management of a network service. But I ended up in the edge on the left. Remember, where that other side of the application runs still in a central DC. So at the same time, while doing the lifecycle management of your application, you still have to traverse all your domains. And what is the difficulty apart from domain, code, and technology, as I explained a second ago? The aspect is you have to transfer organizations inside, let's say, departments inside your own organizations. It's a people thing. It's a communication thing, right? It's not only a technology thing, right? And therefore, landing an application for the sake of the argument in the edge, sending an email back to another department, then learning that basically he has his out of office on, and therefore you get an email back. That's not the way to do things, right? The other thing with respect to applications is the money will come to you as a service provider through the application. In other words, the revenue generating capacity that comes to you comes through the application. So as you land the application, you better somehow have a means to land your network, because the one goes with the other. If that is then the case, application being fully automated, IT industry, massive data centers, all purely operationalized through software, you have to operationalize your network services across end-to-end through automation and through software. And that's the next section that I'm going to say, which is basically automation is going to be key to make all this happening. And so we explained before that there are the three domains. You see there the control plane, where there is indeed a one controller doing what it is really good at with respect to like 50,000 nodes. Where there is a fabric controller that is really good at really getting it operationalized pure and only about repeatability. And then you have an edge that is a little bit of a combination of everything. And by the way, 4RUs, right? You still want to do that all the way end to end, right? And so what we then propose is cross-domain network orchestration, building on where we are currently with the industry, but the industry is both the network side of the industry as well as the IT side of the industry. How can we now best combine them to do something, well, you will see in a second, but that actually is a little bit, let's say, in terms of a paradigm shift, so doing things a bit differently, right? The first thing is we observe today that, well, actually the previous presentation talked about it, I think the word fell a few hundred times, which is, you know, we are talking about young, we are talking about modeling, The industry is there now more or less, even if Young exists already for quite a number of years. Now it's like more or less getting commonplace. So that means you can start for each of the domains by an observation that it is intent-based API-driven, right? Now, there is an aspect with respect to intent-based API-driven. So if I'm talking to you guys as networking guys, then I would call it Young. If I were to talk to you as IT guys, I would have called it Richardson Maturity Model Level 2, which is pure the way that you do HTML calls, right? These APIs are machine readable. You can process them. You basically can translate it from one model to another model, but pure by a machine and by an algorithm. In other words, the first step starts by the intent-based API. Young is really a very good example from that perspective. It's a perfectly workable, model that is with the JSON schema and so on, a little bit technical terms, that is purely by IT guys. They really know what to do with it. It's really very well model-based, right? And so what we then say is it becomes really consumable as the API and as the model and the methods that are expressed by the API. That's the first step. We are going to onboard that in the way that we take that fresh look into network orchestration. The second step is, okay, we start with intent-based. The second step is there is an industry standard out there that actually, if you Google on Kubernetes, it has the word orchestrator by default in it. It has the word application before it, and remember application we had in the first slide and in the second slide already on the table too. So we were asking ourselves, if there is already an application orchestrator out there that, by the way, works natively with exactly the same JSON schemas as we have in Young, couldn't we leverage it? Because the orchestrator part is already there. It's called the Kubernetes control plane. That's actually your orchestrator. And you go through a number of, through the API server, to your worker nodes to then deploy a pod, which then stands for an application. This pod is a concept for a container. You have a replica set, you can do a service, you can do an ingress, and all these resource definitions are these resource definitions that are defined upfront in Kubernetes for your application orchestration. Now, Kubernetes is extendable. You have custom resource definitions, and it allows you to add something to it. So that is then the next thing. What we are proposing is in the control plane of Kubernetes to basically take the intent-based API-driven and remap it into the Kubernetes models, right? So that is basically explained in here. The way to do that, it's called an operator. So operator is really a Kubernetes wording. It's nomenclature specific. Well, it's nomenclature specific in this presentation, specific for Kubernetes. And it stands for the fact that you have a custom resource definition, which is actually an exact representation of your intent-based API, 100%, 0.00 accurate, that you then map into your intent operator. And then Kubernetes has what is called a reconciler. That is the controller manager calls for a control loop. It's called the custom controller. And it will hunt persistently to get the intended state that you expressed in your resource definition, to get your intended state in line with the state in your application setup. And what we are saying is, let's do the same to get the intended state in line with your state on your switch, right? So we just do the same wording and we replace application by network service or switch. And everything else stays the same, right? And so the point is then that when you look at the one controller, it becomes an intent operator. You look at the fabric controller, it becomes an intent operator. You have an operator next to an operator, next to an operator, next to an operator, all what is then called Kubernetes resource model aligned. So you really have aligned the thing with respect to what you are doing and what you want to get in terms of network services, because at the end of the day, don't forget it, we are actually doing network services. We are still network designers, right? And that is then expressed basically in the, what you then call the cross-domain network intents. So the cross-domain network intents, they will go to the Kubernetes system. There is nothing specific that we write in terms of software code. We just express the intent in terms of the end-to-end network design across the edge, the one, and then the central data center. And that is then going to be processed by the Kubernetes control plane through the mechanisms that it has inherently in itself. And as a result, you go through the proper intent-based API-driven controllers. at the bottom, right? The net result is that basically, that's what I call out there in the third call out, as cloud native as can be, it all lives therefore in Kubernetes in itself, right? So from that perspective, you really can now take the wording, the application orchestrator, by the extension of the blue boxes, also has become, the light blue boxes also have become a network orchestrator. And therefore, Kubernetes is our network orchestrator, thanks to the few extensions only. We don't change anything to Kubernetes itself, we only extend it, right? And as a result, and that's what I, at some point it's a little bit like a paradigm shift that you have to think in your mind about, is a network service becomes an application as any other application for Kubernetes. That has giant implications, that statement, right? Let me first call out the first implication, which is Kubernetes has what is called role-based access. In role-based access, you can give certain objects access, certain roles access to certain objects or deny them access. But that allows, again, to bring the domains back to the organization model inside your organizations, right? Which stands for a network designer will still design his networks. It will not be an IT guy and it will not be the data center guy. It will be a network guy, network designer, who designs the network service. He will design it in a declarative intent, and then he will give the rights to the operators of the network, and it can be that application department, it can be that network operations stack that just associates input values to the template upon basically approval, and therefore we call it delegation of authority, basically. That is then all Kubernetes managed. Kubernetes has all the mechanisms to exactly do that. And as a result, even if it's all IT, the network designer still does what he needs to do with respect to what he's good at, which is network designs, right? Consequences, GitOps, plus network that I call the designers of the network, consumers of the network. Now GitOps that we know from the IT industry has become NetOps, because the networking together then with the way that you design the net, plus the GitOps, basically you concatenate it together, and this is fundamentally what NetOps is all about, right? But there is more to it. Basically, GitOps is what you find in the open source. Argo is what you find in the open source. Prometheus is what you find in the open source with respect to monitoring. Fluentd with respect to logging is what you find in open source. Now, all of a sudden, be above that Kubernetes resource model where you have your intents for your network services, the entire ecosystem becomes at your disposal. By the way, open source, right? So the impact of that is like giant. And therefore, you can start with some, you basically can start in your own department, bring it to the other departments as you go along, as you then create levels of communication through these tools and so on. They are all built exactly for that. It makes your network, therefore, much more consumable, your services consumable by the application, as I said from the beginning. It makes you much more agile. Give it a try. Basically, do it on a pre-production. Get a template into the production. From there, it's triggered from GitOps into Argo CD, and hubs it flows through, right? You really can go much more into a factory type of a way to do your network services. And the last one, as then I said, net result, your network service is physically laid out in terms of packets actually flowing end-to-end in a fully automated way. That basically sums up how we see network orchestration, taking the best of the IT, basically for your benefit in terms of going after new revenue. Thank you.